Donald Trump's election as the 45th president of the USA was announced on the 10th of November last year, and his term in office will be remembered for many reasons in the history books. Now, during his campaigns, Trump made these controversial views known about women, the fight against terrorism, migration, and even global warming. In week one, he's already signed orders involving funding for abortion clinics and Muslim travel bans. However, very little has been said about the future of U.S.-Africa relations, leading the African continent to wonder about the impact his term in office could have on their interests. But before we talk about Africa, I'd like to introduce Professor John Stremlau this morning. Very good morning to you, Prof. Thanks for being with us.
Thank you.
I wish it could be under different circumstances. How do you read what's going on in America right now and the kind of responses we see around the world?
Well, I've never seen anything quite like it. He's only 10 days into his new term, and already he's broken a lot of China, and there's been reaction. So that the ban question, which is the most immediate one now of Muslims, has tended to galvanize opposition and remind us that he may be defeatable in the courts, in the streets, and in other ways. And so that I hope your earlier story referencing the African Union summit, yes, South Sudan is a terribly important issue, but also African leaders need to talk about how to work around Donald Trump. Mm. And it's not just work around America. It's work around Donald Trump and build linkages to diaspora communities, to artist communities like John Leonard, legend that was just quoted, and find ways to show this man that he cannot do what he's so arbitrarily trying to do now.
Talk to me about this man, because I can't put him together. His mother was an immigrant. His wife is an immigrant. Yeah. But he signs all these anti-immigration laws. It sounds a lot like out-and-out racism to me.
Well, that's the way I would interpret it as well. But and it's very difficult for me to put myself in his shoes. Mm. I had a much easier time understanding what Obama was trying to do than Donald Trump. However, it does appear that he has no relationship with truth, so that he can make up what he says, and the moment he says it, it becomes in his mind truth, and then he'll say something else a little later on. The inconsistencies in the man's life, so long as it's promoting himself and making money in the old days and maybe now, that's good enough for him, and it's not good enough for the country or for the world.
We're asking that question to our viewers. Is Donald Trump, is he making the world a much more dangerous place? Now, we see pronouncements of people who don't normally pronounce. Gorbachev has come out and he says, this guy's making the world a dangerous place and it could lead to much more. There we have our viewers voting. 78% say, yes, he is making the world a more dangerous place. Do we have to be concerned about this danger, or let's call it the temperature rising around the world?
Well, you have to be concerned about someone who is disrupting expectations that governments have had in order to conduct their business. I mean, you've got to have, in the absence of a world government, you've got to have some mutual confidence that whoever is speaking on behalf of another state does so with the authority of that position. Trump's authority is going to be challenged, and the process that's taking has to be watched very carefully and countered also by thoughtful governments around the world. If he's going to, for example, cut the UN budget by 40%, the U.S. contribution, well, maybe it's time for South Africa, the AU, to say, maybe the Chinese should offer to host the United Nations in Hong Kong, for example. Remind the Americans, because within the American body politic, when the world speaks, a lot of people are listening, just like you listen here. Mm-hmm. It's not just Trump's voice.
Yeah. What about this idea, and it's been mooted on social media, the kind of the hatred that's being pressed, spouted by Trump? It reminds a lot of what happened in Nazi Germany in the 30s. Do you share that kind of view, or is that alarmist?
I think the Nazi analogy may be too overdrawn, but not the overdrawn. There's analogies to strong men everywhere across Africa, playing the nationalist card or the tribal card, which in the case of Trump, it's the disaffected white minority, but still a very outspoken and energized one that brought him the presidency. And so finding ways to contain the autocratic tendencies that is very uncongenial to American democratic traditions imperfect as the American democracy is. And so he is a counter force, and the contrast between the Democrat Obama, committed to due process, rule of law, and the rogue autocratic Trump. It's ironic that one is black and one is white. I think this is kind of a useful sign of the way the world may be going. Is worth remembering, and remember that Obama still is very popular in Africa and has an important legacy. Trump is not, as your poll just saw. Okay, that's got to register on the Americans sooner or later.
The first week in office has been hectic, to use one word. What is the outlook, you think, for Africa, and what do you think can Africa expect in its negotiations with Donald Trump, if you can call it that?
Well, I have tried to understand where the Trump administration might go in Africa. And there was in the New York Times a reported four-page list of questions that the team asked of the Pentagon and of the State Department. It sounded to me plausible. The U.S. government is saying this was a case of false news, whereas the New York Times is pretty careful about this. So who knows what these questions reflect, but they did suggest that Trump is skeptical of foreign aid, that Trump doesn't like, for example, a free trade agreement. So all these South African cars going into the U.S. market, even though it's under congressional mandate in the law, the AGOA, the African Growth and Opportunity Act, those kind of things could be challenged. And if they are challenged, Africa's got to push back.
Talk to us about an executive order, because this has been the buzzword the last week or so, the executive orders that have been signed, what it means for, of course, Muslims traveling in and out. But what is an executive order, and how does it affect people on the ground?
Well, I grew up not knowing much about executive orders, because in the better days of American due process and politics, Congress and the president would negotiate solutions. Obama found a very hostile, you could even say racist, Congress, a Republican majority, that frustrated everything he did. So he turned to executive orders, which the president is allowed to do within certain limits. So that Trump, you can see the challenges to this Muslim ban. The courts are saying, wait a minute, this may not be constitutional. But this is very transactionally costly and delays everything. Executive orders can be facilitating for simple things, holidays and regulations about employment, but not when they're dealing with something like immigration. And so executive orders have been used more aggressively, both by Obama, but now with Trump, without regard for, I think, where the body politic is. Obama was much more sensitive to where the body politic was.
In conclusion, the Muslim hashtag, Muslim ban, as it's now being called, how do you see it ending? How do you see it playing out? Not well, I would think.
Well, it's very interesting because the facts don't jibe with what he's done. Of the 89 alleged terrorists been apprehended in the U.S. since 9/11, 42 of them are American citizens. So that, and the others are from countries not on the seven list. And the human stories that have come out from the airports around the country are very poignant and are galvanizing support, just as the Women's March, which was, you know, three times bigger than Trump's turnout for the inaugural in Washington and around the world. So we're at the start of a process of pushback against Trump, and we'll have to see where the next few weeks and months go, but it's accelerating a lot faster than I ever imagined it would. I thought he'd back off, but he hasn't.
Prof, thank you for coming in. Always great to have you with us and have your considered view about something that's concerning, I think, all of us around the world, is the Trump factor. Hashtag resist. That's what the opposition to Trump are saying. We all need to be activists and become active in this fight, for equality and a whole host of other things that are under threat in the world right now. Thank you, Prof.